Hi, here is Peter from YouRender. In this video, I will give you an overview about our brand new and amazing feature, Volumetrics. You can do a lot of cool things like increasing the atmosphere of your scenes within a few clicks. And all of this is of course in real time. How do you set them up? First, you have to activate them in the render settings. Second, you have to create a volume object. And third, you need a light source. At the moment, we provide two kinds of volume objects, layer and cube. Layer creates an infinite volume with a gradient that can be adjusted very easily. The cube generates a volume inside of the borders of a cube. You can imagine the volumetrics as three-dimensional grid we call voxels. So one important setting is the resolution of the voxel grid. The higher the resolution, the more details you can achieve with the cost of more render time. We have a global subdivision slider here to adjust the resolution very quickly. You can adjust the resolution for X, Y, Z independently. This is because in many cases you would need more resolution in the Z axis compared to the X and Y axis. Furthermore, it is always good to have more flexibility to optimize your settings. By default, we have 16 voxels in X and Y and 32 in Z. Multiplied with 8 subdivisions are over 65,000 voxels. There is another thing that is really important for the resolution in Z. The voxels are distributed along the far clipping distance of the camera, so I really recommend to use a YouRender camera tag and set the clipping planes manually as close as possible to get the best result. If your background objects are very far away, the far clipping plane may be too large to get a good resolution in Z. In this case, you can use the volumetrics far clipping value. This won't cut off your geometry in the background and only affects the volumetrics. The temporal jittering blends voxels from former frames. This can prevent stripy artifacts that appear because of too low voxel resolution. But the volumetrics get a little bit blurry. You can adjust the size of the jitter radius, how strong this option will affect the render result. A little hint. If you make a cool shot with nice God rays facing the camera, you should not set your near clipping plane value too high, because you also would cut off the volumetrics and the streaks of the God rays. Oh, did I say God rays? Let's make a quick example. Change the volume object to layer and create a text or any kind of mesh. Adjust the light source, set it to inverse square, set a shadow mode, and then you have to check your YouRender light tag and activate enable mesh shadows. If the shadow is cut off, you can set the mesh shadow range manually. I recommend to use soft edge shadows because they soften the God rays a little bit. In the layer volume object, you have two medias. Media A is the upper and media B the lower one. You are able to blend them in between. By default, the media A has density 0, so media B is fading into the empty environment. You can set the global density in the render settings or the density in the volume object. That's useful if you have more volume objects in the scene with different densities. There is also a phase slider. This slider lets you regulate if the light is scattered more in the near of the light source or if the light is passing through the volumetrics. There is one thing that may be a little bit confusing at first. If you set the density to 0, the volumetrics seem to be not visible, and by slowly increasing the value, it's getting brighter and brighter until it reaches a value where it seems to get darker again. That's because by increased density, the volumetrics are blocking more and more light. The reason for that is that a medium with more density is scattering sooner the light that tries to pass through the media. If we look from the side view, we can even see that the scene gets completely dark. And that's because there is also a media between the camera and the cone of the spotlight, but they are completely unlit. And when these unlit volumetrics increase their density, they totally begin to block the light like a black wall. This is caused through a global extinction value for the volumetrics. These are the main steps you have to do to activate the volumetrics. By default, they look very uniform, but you can set the noise to get a more interesting result. You have a couple of settings that define the look of the noise. On one side, you have the octaves, lacunarity, persistence, and scale to define the shape and detail of the noise. On the other side, you can use global adjustments like brightness and contrast to adjust how soft they are. When tweaking the noise values, I prefer to set the contrast to a high value because it's easier to see how changing the values impact the volumetrics. So let's have a closer look to the values. Octaves. The number of octaves controls the amount of detail of the noise. So adding more octaves increases the detail of the noise. Lacunarity and persistence work as multiplier, how quickly the frequency increases for each octave. That means these values add even more details to your noise. By increasing the lacunarity, there is still the main shape that the octaves define visible. While increasing the persistence, the look gets more and more like a fine noise. Using the low clip slider is a good way to get less cloudy shapes until they completely disappear. If you need more control, you also can use the gradient curve. So let's set the contrast to 0 and the low clip to default. When you are happy with the look of your volumetrics, you can animate the noise itself, as well as moving around the volumetric object, or set a movement animation, or mix it all together. We have three modes for the noise space: World, Object, and Custom. When you set it to World, the noise itself doesn't move if you are moving, rotating, or scaling the volume object. In Object Noise Space, you can position your noise as you like. Custom lets you define a noise transform object, like a null or any other kind of object. Now you can animate the movement of the noise by animating your transform object. If you parent a transform object under your volume object, you get the same behavior like in object noise space mode. In addition to that, you can use the movement animation options. You have the same modes like the noise space provides. It's useful if you have animated the volumetrics with a noise transform and then want to add an overall additional movement in any kind of direction. The speed value acts as multiplier for the movement X, Y, and Z. Time to check how we can improve the look of the volumetrics even further. Go to the light tag and activate volumetric shadows. This has a huge impact on the look of your volumetrics. The volumetric shadows allow the volumetrics to cast shadows on itself, depending on the density. So the more density the volumetrics have, the stronger the shadowing effect. The volumetric shadows do also cast shadows on meshes, so let's create a plane. If you need more details for the volumetric shadows, you have separate resolution settings in the light tag. Let's create a second volume object and leave its default layered mode. Adjust the density and you see that even the volumetrics are casting God rays into the layer volume object. That's really impressive. You also can exclude light sources from interacting with the volumetrics by unchecking the volumetric checker box in the General tab of the light tag. For final quality, you can increase the subdivision slider in the volumetrics render setting. Too high values may bring your graphics card memory to its limits, so you have to test how far you can go. Have fun with volumetrics and thanks for watching!